Hello all, welcome back. The last session of today. My name is Larry Dowie. I'm the manager of collections and special projects at the rooms, which basically means for the last 3 years, I've given over my life to the First World War. We meet every Monday from 2 to 4 to discuss First World War related issues. And in that capacity over the years, I've had the good fortune to meet and work with Dr. David Parsons. So I extend my condolences to the family, and I was thrilled to hear that the organizing committee are honoring him today by giving this symposium over to him. I have three wonderful, creative, interesting people at my side that I'll introduce, and they'll present in the order which I have them here. They've all got very long curriculum vitaes. I had to narrow it down to a couple of chapters. So bear with me. First we have up is Sean Cadigan. He's the Associate Vice President Academic Faculty Relations Pro Tempore and a professor of history at the prestigious Memorial University. His teaching and research interests include all aspects of history in Newfoundland and Labrador, the social, the ecological history of fishing communities, and the history of the working people generally. He is published and well established in the book world. One of his books is Hope and Deception in Conception Bay, Merchant-Settler Relations in Newfoundland. Another book was Newfoundland and Labrador, A History, that was published in 2009. And his most recent foray was Death on Two Fronts, National Tragedies and the Fate of Democracy in Newfoundland, 1914 to 1934. And today he's going to be talking a little about post-war commemorative rhetoric developed as a reaction to William Coker. Our second presenter is Moira Hanrahan. I've had the pleasure of doing some work with Moira during the past couple of years. So Moira is the chair of the Humanities Program at the Grenfell campus in beautiful Corner Brook, and she's a member of the Campus Environmental Policy Institute. She brings with her a PhD from the London School of Economics and Political Science, where she was the Rothmere Fellow and a graduate fellow. Prior to that, she graduated from Memorial and Carleton Universities. Moira has also published, she's the author or editor of 3 academic books and 7 other books in other genres, all influenced by her academic research, and she has a number of award-winning books as well. Her novel is Sheila's Brush, published by Iana of Toronto, and that won the prestigious Independent Press Award in New York. Her short fiction has won awards in Canada, the United States, and Britain. And I stand corrected, Moira is actually first to present. And then, no less, the young Stephanie Tucker. How old am I getting? I work with Stephanie's mother. I remember Stephanie when she was... So Stephanie is a graduate of Memorial University alumni. So she graduated in the spring of 2015 with a Bachelor of Arts in Communication Studies and English. At her convocation, Stephanie was awarded the George M. Story Convocation Medal in Arts and the A.C. Hunter Prize in English and the University Medal for Academic Excellence in Communication Studies. She is interested in videography, public relations, and marketing, which led her to her current position as the Communications and Marketing Coordinator for the local nonprofit organization Conservation Corps of Newfoundland and Labrador. In this role, Stephanie is currently working on creating a new website for the organization and producing environmental TV show that will air in the fall of 2016. She was a student in 2014, when a student in 2014, she traveled over to Harlow, England for a study abroad program called Literary London. During her time abroad, Stephanie and her classmates had the opportunity to visit Beaumont Hamel, the Newfoundland Memorial in France. And today, Stephanie will offer the youth perspective on visiting Beaumont Hamel, and she will play a video that she created with her classmates while she was on that visit. So I will ask Moira to take the podium.
Okay, so thank you, Larry, and thank you for your wonderful assistance with the project that I'm going to talk about today. And I'd also like to thank Doug Ballum and the World War 100 Fund for helping me out and having me here today. So my paper is titled The Mi'kmaq of Newfoundland in World War I, Stories from Home and Away. In his last letter home on June 29, 1916, Mayo Lind, who was killed at Beaumont Hamel, noted that before the big push, the Germans had held up a sign asking, when are the white Indians from Newfoundland coming over? Like the derogatory Jackitar, the name seems to have stuck. In 1917, Player and Sons, the cigarette company, issued a series of colonial and Indian army badges or cards about the size of a playing card. The 1st Newfoundland Regiment is identified on trading card number 14 as the White Indians. This is one of the few tokens of recognition Mi'kmaq soldiers from Newfoundland ever received. With funding from the World War 100 Living Memorial Fund, I compiled a database of these soldiers, working with PhD student Michael Westcott in history here in St. John's. And the project identified 157 soldiers and sailors, and I believe that there are more that have not been identified. So this is a map giving you an idea. I do have to turn around and look. So you see the cluster. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay, so, and this reflects the Mi'kmaq diaspora throughout the island, and with the biggest cluster there around St. George, Bay St. George, Port-au-Port area, and that's where our pullout is. So these are the communities that the soldiers and sailors come from. So Buren, for instance, only had one. Flat Bay, there were 26 men who enlisted. Of those identified, 84 joined the Newfoundland Regiment, while 53 joined the Newfoundland Royal Navy Reserve. A version of the database will be posted on the QE2's website this summer, and I'll present on my interpretation of Mi'kmaq wartime motivation in Poland next week at the Multi-Ethnic Society of Europe and the Americas conference, again, thanks to the fund. If you want to, you'll have to come with me to Poland if you want to hear my theoretical ideas about Mi'kmaq motivation and participation. But here I'm going to indulge a little in some storytelling with an overview of aggregate Mi'kmaq participation in the First World War. So when I started doing the research for the database, the first significant finding I had was that the Mi'kmaq enlisted in very high numbers. I expected, if you had asked me to guess before I started, I might have thought 50, but so far I've come up with 157 men. They're all men. I couldn't find any women, but I would be delighted to. Even at the time, the enthusiastic Mi'kmaq participation in World War I was noted. As Governor Davidson wrote after a visit to Miabegeg, more widely known as Con River, I met the principal men of this settlement of Con River 2 years ago when fishing on a tributary of the Gander River. They trek across from Bay de Spere to the Gander River every year on fishing, trading, and hunting expeditions. Now the whole of the settlement is empty, as the men have volunteered in the regiment, and very athletic and likely-looking soldiers they were, with the physical characteristics which the New Englanders have in common with the noble redmen, tall, narrow-shouldered, lantern-jawed, fearless men with prominent features. That's Governor Davidson. Flat Bay, Bay St. George was the center of Mi'kmaq life in western Newfoundland, and it is probable that all the Mi'kmaq of the island, including those at Con River, descend from Bay St. George Mi'kmaq communities. What we now call Flat Bay was made up of several small communities at the time. There was St. Teresa's, Muddy Hole, Bankhead, Middlebrook, and Flat Bay East and West. And as I said, virtually every male resident of Flat Bay enlisted for a total of 26 men. Families were very large, with many cases of 15 children or more, according to census data and local histories. And there were often other relatives living in the house, frequently children who had been adopted, since adoption was and is an honored practice in Mi'kmaq and other Indigenous cultures. One of the most striking stories from Flat Bay is that of the five Young brothers who all went to war. Rachel Bennett Young and her husband George, Rachel Benoit Young, sorry, and her husband George had no less than half of their 10 sons overseas. John, Edward, Albert, Andrew, and George, they sound very royal. John enlisted the year he turned 15, so he might have been 14 at the time. He gave his age as 16. John and his brothers Edward, Albert, and George all joined the Naval Reserve, while Andrew, who was only 16, joined the Newfoundland Regiment. Now, Rachel's heart must have been in her mouth for 4 long years until John, her youngest, was discharged in May 1919. Although Andrew had been hospitalized for a time in Halifax in 1917, thankfully, all of Rachel's sons survived the battlefields. Excuse me. But in common with many Mi'kmaq soldiers, Edward would die of tuberculosis not too long after returning home, while Albert also had an untimely death at 38. But all the young brothers made it through the war itself. There are Mi'kmaq soldiers buried here in the cemetery at St. Anne's in Flat Bay. St. Anne is the patron saint of Mi'kmaq, and she's the grandmother of Jesus. She's Mary's mother. And other Mi'kmaqs, the Youngs included, are buried down the road from here, about 5 miles down the road in St. Teresa's Cemetery. One of the young brothers, George, lived to be 90, and he died in his hometown, so he spent his whole life there. I'll show you another couple of burial spots. Oops. Wait now. See, I told you I'd have technical difficulties. How do I?
Just distance is on its way.
Okay. Sorry. I want to show you a couple more burial sites, and these are Mi'kmaq graveyards on the west coast of the island.
So to advance.
To the right and go backward.
Yeah.
And there's a point there. Came up in the later slides.
Yeah, okay, maybe. Thank you. Okay, so this is the new Stephenville Cemetery, and there's a section there for First Nations people. Mi'kmaq and the old word Mi'kmaq. Mi'kmaq is, the word means kin friends, and the correct spelling is right there in the middle, and Mi'kmaq was a corruption of that. So there are probably, I'm thinking, 20, 30 headstones in there. Maybe one of them is a veteran, if I recall correctly. Just going to have to play around with this. Yes, this is a cemetery at Cape St. George, another Mi'kmaq cemetery right at the edge of the Port-au-Prince Peninsula. And there are also some Mi'kmaq buried there who went to war. Narcissist Chasson is one of them. Campbells, Lemoines, other names too, they're buried there. You'll see that the French language is there and the Mi'kmaq language. And I don't know if anybody here has been out to Port-au-Prince in recent years, but all this, the signs are trilingual. So they're in English, Mi'kmaq, and French, very multicultural. I've spent the past 3 years on the West Coast. It's very, very different from the East Coast, and real education for me. So the main preoccupations of the Mi'kmaq in the database were fishermen, 35 of them were fishermen, lumbermen, 16, although most were engaged in a seasonal round of economic activities in which hunting and trapping figured very prominently. There were four miners from the Port-au-Port Peninsula and three trappers, Peter Jador, Benjamin and Peter Benoit, all from Con River. Ralph MacDonald from St. George's was a furrier. Four of the men were farmers. Some were likely guides as their fathers had been, at least part of the year. Print ads from the time encouraged visiting anglers and sports hunters in Newfoundland to hire Mi'kmaq guides. The majority of the pre-war occupations, however, were not recorded. Although there appears to be no academic work done on Mi'kmaq labor history in Newfoundland, community and family stories hold that Mi'kmaq were marginalized in the Newfoundland economy. So when the mill opened at Cornerbrook, for instance, Mi'kmaq men had to hide their identity, the stories go, if they could, to get hired. And of course, many could not. In fact, only one soldier reported that he worked at the pulp and paper mill. Now, working in the lumber industry in frigid central Newfoundland, Mi'kmaq weren't allowed to eat their lunches indoors right into the 1960s and so on. So they were pretty marginal, at least anecdotally, on the in economic terms. Although I believe there were other deeper reasons for such high Mi'kmaq involvement in World War I, and I elaborate on these elsewhere in other venues, I should note that in Canada, many First Nations people saw the military as an opportunity to level the economic playing field. It offered them the chance to use their skills, since many were hunters, and the Innu snipers are an example of this. War work promised a steady paycheck. For most Mi'kmaq, this would be their first ever. The economic appeal of the military would have been there for many other Newfoundlanders as well, but it would have been especially significant for Mi'kmaq with their large families and their precarious place on the edge of the economy. The Canadian connections are notable. 14 of the men in the database enlisted in Canadian units and 2 in American units. All of these men were from the West Coast, where Mi'kmaq from the Maritimes still traded and married into communities. Indeed, this practice still occurs today. Just last weekend, Mi'kmaq elders from Nova Scotia were honored guests at the Bay of Islands Maui'omi, or gathering, in Benoit's Cove. Now, one of these men was Mose Muse. I'll find him here. Sorry about this. You did see him earlier. There he is. Mose Muse. He was a blacksmith living in St. George's, when he joined the Newfoundland Regiment at age 20. Mose had been born in Eastern Harbour, Cape Breton, and with his immediate and extended family, moved to Newfoundland in 1896 when he was a small boy. The group had come temporarily with Bishop Neil McNeil, a Catholic bishop, but they knew people in the Mi'kmaq community there, and they liked Newfoundland, and they decided to stay. So in 1911, Mose was farming with his father while his older brothers Alex and Benjamin worked as lumbermen. The family is listed as Roman Catholic and British in that year's census, as was the case with most Mi'kmaq families. Mose was wounded twice overseas and taken prisoner at Monchy-le-Preux. He did hard labor for the Germans until the end of the war, although he seems to have made the best of it. Years later, he told Ivan Young, "When I arrived at the prisoner of war camp, the German guards had never heard of Newfoundland and were not impressed when I told them it was a British colony. They thought it was part of Canada. I used to tell them about the trout and salmon fishing and the caribou hunting. They all said they would like to come and visit me when the war was over. One day, one of the guards told me the war would soon be over and we began to hear gunshots not far away. It was getting closer every day. One morning we awoke and the Germans were gone. How happy we were to meet the British, Australians, and Canadians. It was so good to eat decent food again. The train loaded us for the coast of France, and I shook hands with my Russian comrades, who promised to visit someday. Now I was on my way to England." Mose emerges from this account as an extroverted, almost jovial individual, a person who had an impressive talent for befriending people in unlikely circumstances. Interestingly, Young recorded that after his war experience, Mose vowed to always treat cats with kindness and to feed them whenever he could. So there's a backstory there I don't know about. He also said repeatedly that he cherished his memories of Christmas dinner as a prisoner of war. Mose returned to his home community after the war. St. George's was sizable by West Coast standards. In 1921, when the next census was carried out, it had about 370 people. Mose returned there and lived with his father, Mose Sr., his mother, Lucy, who had been born in Margaree, Nova Scotia, and his younger brother, Harry, he was called Harry. Mose married three times. First to Mary Ellen Barter, who was Mi'kmaq from Cape St. George, with whom he had two children. Then after her death to Ada Poirier, probably from St. George's, with whom he had five children. In 1935, Mose was living in St. George's with Ada, who was 13 years his junior, with six children ages 1 to 10. After Ada died, Mose married Mary Swires of Sandy Point. They had no children. Mose died in St. John's in 1952. He was only 59, but he left no less than 50 grandchildren, at least two of whom are recognized as Mi'kmaq elders today, Odell Pike and Victor Muse, who supplied this photograph of Mose. Mose's great-granddaughter, Janelle Duval, is a noted singer and drummer with Eastern Owl, a First Nations women's drum group here in St. John's. Now, there are many other maritime connections besides those of the Muse family. Mi'kma'ki, the land of the Mi'kmaq, extends from the Gaspé Peninsula in Quebec to Maine to the island of Newfoundland, and people traveled far and wide with the seasons so they could take advantage of resources like salmon and wood and meet with others with each other in gatherings, which, as I said, still occur today. The Mi'kmaq were skilled sailors and were spotted in shops off Massachusetts in the 16th and 17th centuries. The Quebec anthropologist Charles Martin described Mi'kma'ki as a domain of islands. Pierre Benoit and Marianne Longpierre, for instance, had moved to Flat Bay from Nova Scotia. No less than nine of their grandchildren from Flat Bay and nearby Shallop Cove enlisted. Austin Benoit, for instance, joined the Newfoundland Regiment at 20 and suffered a gas shell wound in August 1917. Austin survived to live a long life, although he was hampered by chronic respiratory problems. Nevertheless, after he returned home, Austin settled for a time at Grand Falls, Windsor, and then during the Commission of Government period became a farmer at Cormac. When his grandsons were six or seven, he gave them guns and taught them how to hunt. Excuse me. Seven of the Benoit's nine soldier grandsons, Austin's cousins and brothers, survived the war. Brothers Fred and Frank Colombe did not. Fred died after being wounded at Gallipoli, while Frank died 2 years to the day after his older brother at Longemark, if I'm pronouncing that properly. A third brother, David, was in the Forestry Corps and returned home safely from overseas. Many of the young Mi'kmaq soldiers were hospitalized during the war. Their list of ailments includes, of course, gunshot wounds, mumps, mental trouble, in quotation marks, perhaps most tragically, gonorrhea, various respiratory illnesses such as bronchitis, influenza, and pneumonia. They seem to be the biggest ones. John Brumsey was from Mattis Point, the small community outside Stephenville Crossing, named for Matty Mitchell, the celebrated Mi'kmaq guide who discovered the zinc, lead, copper, gold, and silver at Buckins. And Chief Brendan Mitchell of Halibut Mi'kmaq First Nation is a descendant of Matty Mitchell's. So Mattis Point is where John Brumsey was from. Sadly, Brumsey and his two little sons' children died within 2 weeks of the end of the war, probably of Spanish influenza. So he got that far, but then succumbed. 17 Mi'kmaq soldiers died during the war. They were aged 19 to 26. The youngest was Peter Benoit, also of Mattis Point, who died of meningitis. Two were lost at sea, four at Monchy-le-Preux, including brothers William and Hector Bennett of Stephenville Crossing, and one at Gallipoli, for a total of seven. The Bennett brothers are buried at Beaumont Hamel. The rest died of illnesses, as we have seen. All of these deaths were pointless. The war itself was a terrible tragedy, leading to awful loss of life and health, especially, as we now understand, mental health. By telling these untold stories and by recognizing the Indigenous culture and heritage of the soldiers I'm studying, I hope I'm able to pay them some small tribute. So thank you. Wailalin.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'm not sure. There, how's that? Okay, good, thanks. Okay, well, thanks, everybody, for attending, and I'm sorry I missed the morning sessions. What I'd like to talk about today in Beyond Beaumont Hamel is how subsequent political debates have influenced the way in which we commemorate the fallen at Beaumont Hamel, and how we commemorate all those who fell during the First World War. And I'll start with what I think is one of two. I don't know if Quebec has a memorial that it calls its National War Memorial. Pardon me? There are only two. Ottawa's, of course, and ours. And our National War Memorial is very typical of war memorials that were constructed after the First World War, in that they all somehow embody images that are a response to concerns about post-war disillusionment and a growing feeling that somehow whatever had been sacrificed in the war was for naught in sort of creeping post-war crises. And so often the need is to reinvent all of those who fell as somehow fallen crusaders, people who had died for an idealized winged victory, that somehow we had fought for freedom, and that that's what people were, noble crusaders, often Christ-like in the imagery about them, very common in the Anglo-American world. That's kind of interesting in the Newfoundland case, because I think the specific contours are shaped by, of course, the specific post-war crisis that develops in Newfoundland. So the basic argument that I want to make here is that memorialization, generally speaking, tends to follow the lines of post-war mythologies that are themselves usually a response to deepening forms of disillusionment after wars. They tend to reflect much more contemporary values, that is to say, the values of people as they exist in that post-war world, rather than they reflect actual memories of the fallen. And that in the particular case of the fallen of Beaumont Hamel, the notion becomes, after the war, through the 20s and early 30s, that they are in fact martyrs to a liberal nation. I'll talk more about what that means. And that that notion of the fallen as martyrs to a liberal nation is a direct attempt to try to discredit progressivism as it was explored in Newfoundland. And I associate the most successful form of that politically with William Coker, the Union Party, and the Fishermen's Protective Union. So first, just a series of images that you're all probably familiar with of the first 500, members of the first 500 training at Pleasantville. And I use these images, or I often think about them, because to me they sort of they sort of prompt a kind of notion of who was actually enlisting in the first year of the war. By and large, very young men, often very difficult to be clear, generally speaking, about what their motivations were. A sense of duty, undeniably important to them, but that would have been a sense of duty to empire, of which Newfoundland was one of the young cubs, along with Canada, Australia, New Zealand, of course, and South Africa, all being called to defend the sort of British lion. Beyond that, a very boyish sense of what it meant to enlist, often informed by senses of adventure. You know, you can almost think of the training camp at Pleasantville having this very sort of Boy Scout-like aura about it. For many people, the need for things like employment, the sense of getting out and seeing the world, all of these things really important to their sense of why they were going, very few going to found a nation or to be a blood sacrifice, as they're later commemorated. I think the basic background for what's happening is being shaped by what, during the war years, was a home front political contest between two broad forces. One set of forces associated with, that's Edward Morris, On your left here, of course, the Prime Minister, and sort of responsible for the war effort, but of course turning much of it over to the National Patriotic Association. He's standing for liberal democracy, by and large taking a kind of free market or laissez-faireist approach to how the war effort should be conducted, really loosely applied, because when it came to railway companies, there was no hesitation to help. But by and large, especially when dealing with social problems, tending to see those as individual responsibilities for which the state shouldn't have a direct responsibility, but leave it to sort of voluntarist organizations. On the other side of the coin, the person who becomes the effective leader of the opposition during the First World War, because he won't support the Patriotic Association, and that's William Coker, part of a liberal union alliance, thanks so much, in the House of Assembly, but he had refused to support the Patriotic Association, refused to support the formation of the Newfoundland Regiment, arguing that it was too expensive for Newfoundland to bear, and that the greatest expense, he argued, would come after the war. It wasn't in putting the regiment in the field. It would be dealing with all of the pensions and other forms of compensation that both returned veterans and the survivors of those who fell in battle would require on an ongoing basis. A huge financial liability, he said, that he could not imagine how Newfoundland would be able to afford it. So he wasn't against the war effort. He basically argued that Newfoundlanders and Labradorians should mobilize in other units of the empire, wherever they might find themselves, rather than forming their own regiment. So that's the basic struggle that's taking place, a constant Coker providing a constant criticism of the war effort, demanding more and more from government an intervention in the economy to moderate things like wartime profiteering and so on. What changes things for Coker, of course, is the tragedy of Beaumont Hamel on the 1st of July. You can see there the basic figures usually used to describe what happened to the regiment on that day. You can see also the quote from Governor Davison about how the world will ring forever with the imperishable fame of of Newfoundland. The people falling at that time as members fighting for a loyal colony, right? Not so much a nation, but a loyal colony worthy of its ancient name. After the tragedy at Beaumont Hamel, you see Coker moderating his views quite a bit in public. He's much less likely to criticize government, much more open to the notion of supporting the government, which comes in 1917 when, for his own reasons, Edward Morris decides the time is up for him, his jig is up, and he needs an exit strategy from Newfoundland, which partially involves the creation of a national government. He invites Coker to join. Coker says, yes, but you've got to go, and quickly. So Coker joins with the understanding that Edward Morris, at the first opportunity, will leave government, which of course he does by January of 1918. In 1918, William Lloyd forms an administration, a liberal, a collaborator with Coker, becomes a prime minister. But most people, most of the opposition papers, the Telegram in particular, and the Daily News, opposition, I mean, in the sense that they had always opposed Coker. At one time, the Evening Telegram was a liberal newspaper, and it supported the liberals, but as Coker becomes much more influential in the liberal union alliance, it becomes quite openly hostile to him and anybody who cooperates with him. So you can see some of the rhetoric being expressed here. At the top, the Daily News, referring to Coker as a supporter, a member of government in 1918, as a great admirer of all things German, an autocrat, you know, just like the German emperor and so on, and the Telegram supports similar kind of perspectives on this. So basically, what you begin to see here is the notion that Coker and whatever he stands for, what he specifically stands for, is more government intervention in the economy of Newfoundland to blunt exploitation and to somehow make life more egalitarian, fairer for people. All of that is being associated with Kaiserism, right? So, and in the newspapers, William Coker becomes a form of Kaiser Bill. Following the Lloyd administration, in the next election, an alliance is formed between Richard Squires and William Coker, in which Coker now is not only a member of the government when it comes to power, becomes the Minister of Marine and Fisheries. Totally alarming for the opposition, in particular his interest in regulating the fishery. You can see there some of the fisheries regulations that he's responsible for passing. And in its commentary on all of this, the Daily News reflects that Coker proved himself to be a Bolshevik of the most dangerous sort. So now he's not only Kaiser Bill, but he becomes Comrade Coker as well in the rhetoric that's surrounding all this. And so he's being identified, and the whole tradition, anything associated with Coker, is being identified with as somehow a betrayal of the real loyal Newfoundlander. In the background on the slide, of course, you can see a painting of Lenin. Of course, the Bolshevik Revolution has occurred, and it's one of the major international stories of the day in Newfoundland. R.F. Horwood is commissioned by the Board of Trade to study post-war adjustment in the union movement to Newfoundland, and he opens his report by stating, "Our labor organizations are reeking with the ideals of the Bolsheviks." Right, and that means they just want a little more and so on, but it's all Bolshevik. On Coker in the election, the Daily News cries, "The sons of our empire and those of our allies in winning the war had supposedly swept away all of this, swept away from nations all individuals of arrogant traits like Coker." And in commenting later on his regulations, the Telegram says, of all of this, "A danger that all honest and patriotic Newfoundlanders must do their utmost to combat and overcome. And Newfoundland can only rid itself of the possible incubus by voting for the Cashin Party," of course, which runs against Squires and Coker, "the men that are able to guide the ship of state safely through the perils of Cokerism first, Squireism, and Bolshevism." Right? It's all linked together. Right? Coker, Squires, and Lenin. That's the cabal. The Daily News harkens back to another image. That is to say, it appeals directly to veterans in the election of 1919 to fight against Coker. And its specific appeal is rise up against, quote, "a Kaiser in the person of W.F. Coker." So that's the basic sort of rhetoric that's emerging after the war. Now, of course, the Squires Coker alliance wins another election in 1923, yet very soon after Squires resigns, and there's a whole period of political instability, it emerges that there are allegations of political corruption, many of them well-founded with Squires, nothing ever proved against Coker. And in the fallout of that, of course, Squires resigns, a series of governments are formed that Coker, to one extent or another, provides some support to, and this leads to an election, in 1924, that is fought on the side of Coker's opponents by Walter Munro. It's very interesting that the investigation into the allegations of corruption led by Hollis Walker leads to a report. And that report becomes a political sensation in Newfoundland. Munro's sort of conservatives, I think they actually call themselves Labour Progressive something or other alliance, but in effect they are what passes for conservatives, wins the June 1924 election, and they campaign almost exclusively against William Coker. If you look at the rhetoric in the press at the time, they're constantly identifying corrupt liberals and the FPU, but they tend to focus a lot on Coker, and they really, really look for veteran support. And so you can see the Daily News headline, almost every day political news on the election is reported under the mast of "From the Front," right? So clearly speaking to that wartime imagery. The Evening Telegram does something very similar, and this is one big banner headline that it uses. The quote is, "The country wants a change, and every man who has the least feeling of patriotism will prove his sincerity by voting for Munro and clean government." So what emerges in Munro's campaign for government is the notion that the best way to memorialize those who had fallen at Beaumont Hamel is to establish a new government, a new form of government, and even a new state, one founded on ideals of political and moral purity in which there would be no corruption, that was all associated with Squires and Coker in particular, and that the best way to memorialize those who'd fallen would be to support Munro, who would build this new and clean form of government, which he, and you can see that embedded in lots of rhetoric that comes out of veterans' writings in the period. Some of it you see in the newspapers. This is from Captain Jack Turner in The Veteran. It appears in 1924, but he likely wrote it late in 1923. And he asks, in commenting on all of the political debates surrounding the Hollis-Walker report and the allegations of corruption, he asks, how would the fallen of Beaumont Hamel think about this? And you can see this part of his poem here, where he sort of asks rhetorically, can they sleep when the freedom that their blood brought dearly has by lesser men been sold? The truth they died for trampled in the mud, their country's name bartered for Judas gold. What's to be done? He says, so sound, fall in, the regiment moves again. Again back to the wall, our country calls. Sore is our need today for gallant men to save her from the foe within her walls. We lift the burning torch again, its light shines through the cloud of shame that lies so deep upon our country's honor. One last fight, and that fight won, our gallant dead may sleep. Well, whatever Walter Monroe did, he didn't found a noble, pure state. He didn't clean anything up. He didn't prove to be much better than all the people who've gone before him. So you can think about the years in which our war memorial is actually constructed here as being those of a downward slide into disillusionment. Monroe's, particularly his taxation policies, but other ways in which he quite clearly ruled in favor of the St. John's elite meant that by 1925 he'd been abandoned by really significant supporters like Cashin, like Gordon Bradley, eventually by 1928 his aunt handed power over to Frederick Alderdice, and in the next general election Squires is back again with William Coker's support. So this interlude does a lot to change the rhetoric, to basically say, you know, that the best way to honor the fallen at Beaumont Hamel, and almost all of those who fell during the First World War, tend to be collapsed into the fallen at Beaumont Hamel at this point. Many subsequent, of course, important battles in which more Newfoundlanders fall, but it's always brought back to those who fell at Beaumont Hamel. And so what we see from 1928 forward, of course, is a deepening of Newfoundland's post-war economic depression, more and more demands for public relief as there's greater and greater economic dislocation. And also during this period, veterans are fighting constantly for greater assistance from the Newfoundland government. And that fight for assistance, grounded in the paltry nature of the pensions provided to the veterans of the Newfoundland Regiment, who were receiving exactly half the pensions, the level of pensions received by their Canadian counterparts. So great demands for public assistance. And that leads to even greater notions that somehow there's something simply inherently wrong with Newfoundland. We've had this sort of built-up expectation that government would be more noble, would be purer, and yet it does not seem able to deal with the burgeoning problems of Newfoundland. And increasingly, the sort of rhetoric starts to emerge that the government is failing because the people themselves are somehow failing those who fell. And you can see more notions of this. This is an editorial from The Veteran in 1930, which talks about how political morality in this country is at a low ebb. People are becoming imbued with the idea, so this is why people are immoral, that governments are elected not for the purpose of properly administering public affairs, but rather to serve as fairy godfathers for every indigent dependent who wants assistance. In all truth, it is time to cry halt. So every widow, every orphan, every child who needs assistance, every injured person, they're all part of the demoralization of Newfoundland. Out of this comes the notion that what Newfoundland needs, again, is a rededication to building a new state. And you can see this rhetoric embedded in a lot of the editorials of newspapers during the 20s, the early 1930s. This one from the Daily News, just on the eve of the collapse of responsible government, and the editorial states, in the conquest of our national troubles, there will be some out of step. There will be others who hesitate and seek any excuse to delay progress. An important quote, let us bear in mind the example of our own boys at Beaumont Hamel and with determination to reach the objective of a new day for Newfoundland. And so again, it's just an example of how all the fallen are conflated to those of Beaumont Hamel. Disregard those who would halt us to reason why and press forward indomitably toward that objective of a better Newfoundland, a better state. Well, the idea that was growing in the background is that somehow Newfoundland needs, of course, to take a rest from all of this upheaval, from its demoralization, and some new, more taller, sun-crowned people would, the argument goes, quoting Oliver Wendell Holmes, they should be brought in to somehow deal with Newfoundland's problems. And of course, one of the more interesting developments, and I'd say shocking developments of the late 20s and the 30s, is this sort of swing to the right in how people think Newfoundland should be organized. This is a quote from William Coker, who's become utterly disillusioned by everything. The rhetoric, the vituperative rhetoric about people being immoral, somehow unable to govern, all of the attacks on him, all of the demands for public relief, and the total inability of government to accomplish any of the progressive goals that he hoped it might be able to do. So his conclusion is, we need a Mussolini. And this is a quote from an editorial that he wrote in 1932. And so he says, what is required for Newfoundland and what is most essential for present conditions is a Mussolini. That's pretty clear, right? There's nothing equivocal there. If a man with a soul encased in steel, experienced and not under 40 years old, appeared on the political horizon in this country today as a Mussolini, I would support him with all my strength. The picture is of Coker and some friends traveling in Italy, visiting ancient ruins. And of course, it's just a reminder that Newfoundland's fish markets, some of the most important, were in the Mediterranean. People visited there, as did Coker, all the time. He sort of witnessed personally the rise of Mussolini, and he was pretty impressed in writing editorials, pretty much saying, you know, those fascists make the trains run on time. They get things right over there. So there was very little secret about this. There were other more important, also very important public figures in Newfoundland who'd also turned towards Mussolini, making it very clear in interviews that they did, in public lectures that they gave, that they knew all about the political violence of the fascists, but that as long as it was directed at the left or anything progressive, it was okay. And both the Daily News and the Evening Telegram, by the way, their official editorial policy through the early 30s was that Mussolini was pretty well okay. The Daily News, I think, only quaking at his foreign policy because they were afraid it might start another world war, but thinking his domestic policies were just fine. So basically, during the war, the desire to deal with Coker, to somehow limit his influence, leads to this rhetoric about how Newfoundland requires that somehow Coker and his progressivism, his policies, are standing against everything that our boys died for on the battlefields of Europe. And that if we want to commemorate those people, we ought to build a pure liberal state in which none of that is an influence. That doesn't work out very well. There's great disillusionment. The rhetoric always upping the ante for how we are supposed to remember the fallen. And I think that is what leads us, of course, to the Commission of Government, pretty famous newspaper cartoon from the period showing, you know, when we get Commission of Government appointed by Britain, we have John Bull, the representation of England, clearing the state of Newfoundland, clearing the path of represented by the train here of things like graft and corruption and so on. Of course, this comes by the mechanism of the Amalry Commission report. I've got up there a picture of David McFarlane's Danger Tree because I think there's a really long-term irony in this that simply represents how later political developments become important values in interpreting how we should remember the fallen. And because the Danger Tree is a book that offers many things, but one of the things it offers through the story of the Goodyear brothers is a decapitation thesis for Newfoundland history. So the decapitation thesis is used in Canadian history to describe one supposed impact of the British conquest of Quebec by basically saying it removed French leadership, it removed the ability of Quebec to establish a strong national presence for itself in North America and replace it with a kind of British head. In Newfoundland, the argument is a different one offered by McFarland, which is represented by the surviving Goodyear brother who talks about what a great shame it's been that his brothers are being betrayed in their memory and all those who fell with them by Newfoundland's entry into Confederation. That is their ultimate betrayal. And that implicit there is the notion that people like the Goodyears hadn't died, of all those who fell, this lost generation hadn't fallen, we would have had people who would have been smart enough to keep us out of this big mess. So that is clearly being shaped by 1949 and, of course, all the events surrounding Confederation. So the basic argument that I've offered here is that post-war troubles shaped our supposed memories of those who fell. Those who fell are almost always identified with those who fell at Beaumont Hamel in the 20s and early 30s, especially in the really important debates about the political future of Newfoundland. The basic argument was that the important monument wasn't something that was going to be built between Duckworth Street and Water Street. It wasn't, of course, Memorial University College, which was another memorial constructed in that period, but it was to be the state itself, a nobler, purer state that would be a rejection of all things Coker or progressive and would return us to the fundamental liberal values, it's argued at the time, of laissez-faire in particular. So it's a liberal rejection of the tradition of progressivism. The post-war crisis that develops in Newfoundland meant that it was simply not possible for anybody to live up to the idealization of the fallen as it was supposed to be represented in this new state, martyred crusaders for liberalism. So that is my argument about Beyond Beaumont Hamel. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Stephanie Tucker, and today I'm here to present to you about Beaumont Hamel through the eyes of youth. I'm a Memorial University alumna, and in fall 2014, I was one of 24 fortunate Memorial University students who was given the opportunity to visit the Beaumont Hamel Newfoundland Memorial in France. As a student in the Literary London program at Mons Harlow campus at the time, I joined all of my classmates and my professors to travel to France for this incredible experience. And I'm here today to tell you about it. I grew up here in St. John's, Newfoundland, and I've lived here my whole life. And so for many of you who had a similar upbringing, I'm sure you can remember studying the First World War in grade school all the way up through high school. I can remember my teachers, you know, doing their lectures about it. I remember there being veterans at all of our school assemblies around Remembrance Day. And I remember studying and reading my textbooks about the First World War. But in particular, the courage and the role of the Royal Newfoundland Regiment, it kind of became ingrained in everybody's memories, and it was just always this thing that was held in such high regard and talked about so much. And I think that many Newfoundlanders kind of share that same feeling and have learned so much about it over the years. But the funny thing about this, though, is that sometimes the more you hear about something, the more it becomes surreal. And it becomes like a story, and you kind of lose touch with the fact that this actually happened. So fast forward a couple of years from the time when I was a high school student, and now I'm a university student preparing to go to the Beaumont Hamel Newfoundland Memorial in France with my two professors, Dr. Donald Nicol, who actually took many of the pictures you'll see in this presentation today, his wife Mary Walsh, and my classmates. And so I'm not sure if excited is the right word, but we were all really nervous and kind of anticipating the visit to Beaumont Hamel. Because it's the type of thing where you're not really sure how you're allowed to feel. So I was happy that we were having this opportunity, but I wasn't sure if that was okay because of the seriousness and knowing what had happened there. So it's a really interesting feeling. And we wondered what it would be like after all the years of studying Beaumont Hamel, you know, to actually go to the place where this took place. And so when I think of a memorial, I always kind of think of a physical structure, So I anticipated that the Beaumont Hamel Newfoundland Memorial would be just that. I expected an area with statues, plaques, and a man-made physical commemoration, much like the War Memorial here in St. John's. And nearly all of my classmates thought the same thing. Most of us were from Newfoundland and Labrador, and those who weren't had been living in the province for several years. And like I said, as Beaumont Hamel is such a prominent part of our history, everybody knew a little bit about it going in. But we certainly didn't know what the memorial itself would be, and we definitely didn't know what Beaumont Hamel would look like nearly 100 years since the battle there took place. So we left our campus in Harlow, England, as you can see there on the map, just north of London, on November 10th, and we began our journey to France to spend Remembrance Day at Beaumont Hamel. And getting there wasn't easy. For those who aren't aware, Beaumont Hamel is pretty much in the middle of nowhere, France. And so we crossed the English Channel, and then we ended up staying in a little town called Albert. And Albert actually was a lot smaller of a town than we anticipated, and there wasn't even a place there that we could all go to supper as a group. So it's super remote. It's really just in the middle of nowhere there. So the night before we visited Beaumont Hamel, we ended up ordering pizzas and sitting around my motel room as a group, just kind of talking about what we thought it was going to be and what we expected for the next day. And little did we know that the next day would become ingrained in our memories as one of the most remarkable experiences of our lives. So the next morning, on November 11th, which was Remembrance Day, we finally arrived in Beaumont Hamel. And it's difficult to explain the way that a place like this can make you feel, but I'll try my best. So upon first glance, I got off the bus, walked into the park, and I could see a visitor center. I could see there was statues. I could see some plaques. It was really touching and a really beautiful physical memorial, which was exactly what I had expected. And I was almost surprised that it was exactly what I had expected. And there was even actually a caribou statue, which is exactly like the one that we have here in Bowering Park that I grew up visiting with my parents. And it was surrounded by native Newfoundland plants, which was kind of cool. It was a sunny day in the park, and the memorial was really beautiful. And then I looked a little bit further, and I could see that there was a field that lay beyond the statues and plaques and the physical memorial. And it wasn't really just a pasture like it appeared. It was almost filled with craters and holes. And there was a meadow, and the meadow kind of looked like a road with a bunch of potholes in it. Like, it was really strange. I hadn't seen anything like it before, because all of the fields here, I picture, you know, a baseball field or a soccer field, and it's very flat. And the ground had so many indents in it that it almost looked like the grass was folding together into a braid from a distance. It was just like nothing we'd ever seen before. And then in the distance, I noticed a graveyard. And that's kind of when Beaumont Hamel stopped being surreal to me and I understood what had really happened there. What I had seen as craters in the ground were actually holes where ammunition had gone off. The braided hills that I'd later walked through that day were the zigzag trenches that were walked through by soldiers during the war. And the grassy green field that I was looking out over was no man's land. And that's the place where people my age went and lost their lives. Which is really hard. It's a lot to take in when you're there. And so having that experience, just kind of seeing that people that were my age and my brother's age and younger from our hometown and from the towns around, it was really humbling, and it was just a lot. And so my classmates and I knew we were really lucky that we got to share this experience from a visitor's perspective and not the way that those before us had to see this field. And so we wanted to share this experience with those back home and show them what a preserved battlefield looks like. And so we worked together to create a video to show our friends and family back home. And what we did there was a beautiful poem that's engraved on a plaque on the way into the Beaumont Hamel Newfoundland Memorial Park. And each of my classmates read a line from the poem. And so we wanted everybody here in Newfoundland to see what we saw that Remembrance Day. And here's the video. Tread softly here, go reverently and slow.
Yea, let your soul go down upon its knees.
And with bowed head and heart abased, drive far.
To grasp the future gain in this soul loss,
where not one foot of this dank sod but drank.
Its surfeit of the blood of gallant men.
For their faith, their hope, for life and liberty.
Here made the sacrifice.
Here gave their lives.
And gave for it willingly,
for you and me.
From this vast altar pile, the souls of men
sped up to God in countless multitudes.
On this grim cratered ridge, they gave their all.
And giving won
the peace of heaven and immortality.
Our hearts go out to them in boundless gratitude.
If ours, then God's for his vast charity.
All sees, all knows, all comprehends, save bounds.
He has repaid their sacrifice. And we?
God help us if we fail to pay our debt.
In fullest full and all instantly.
Thank you so much. And in closing, I'm so thankful to have had the opportunity to go to the Beaumont Hamel Newfoundland Memorial in France, thanks to the World War 100 program at Memorial University. Oh, we got some chirps going on back here. Oh, no worries. So thank you so much to the World War 100 program for making this opportunity possible. It really puts things into perspective and makes you more grateful for the safe and happy life that you live today, thanks to those men who lost their lives. And by being there at the memorial, you live it, and you get to be a real part of our history, and the surrealism definitely ends. So while not everybody will have the opportunity to go to Beaumont Hamel, if you do, I certainly encourage you to do so. It's beautiful and touching, and it certainly changed my life. Thank you.
Thank you.
So now we have a few minutes for some questions.
Thank you to all the speakers. Very, very interesting day, the whole day. Thank you. Stephanie, with your group there, were there other schools, if not universities or colleges? I know when I visited on two occasions, there seemed to be a lot of high school students visiting. Did you have that experience?
Yes. Actually, when we were there, we were the only group from Newfoundland, which was really cool. They sang the Newfoundland anthem when we were there, which was really nice. I know they don't always do it, but that was kind of cool. But there was a couple of other high school groups doing the EF tours, if you've heard of those before. They're really popular. I know they offer them there a lot. And so those students were kind of going around, and we spoke with many of them who thought it was really interesting that we were from the place that all these soldiers were from. So yeah, there definitely was.
I know in some of the Canadian literature there was certainly resistance to Aboriginal enlistees and particular problems that they experienced in the forces. Have you seen any of that in your research?
Well, I guess my research started at a very basic level just to find out who the Mi'kmaq soldiers and sailors were, because we didn't have the Indian Act or any similar legislation that would have identified Indigenous people to the authorities. So I just had to figure out who was who. And the database is pretty basic. It gives information on what community, their name, their parents, what community they came from, their age, the unit they served in, whether they were injured or died, where they're buried. It's got photos of headstones and so on. I have done a little bit of searching for firsthand accounts that might give some of that kind of information. I haven't found anything here, and the Newfoundland Mi'kmaq weren't organized in the manner, they didn't have Indian Act bands and so on that they did have across Canada. So they weren't organized in a manner that would allow them to express any official, at least, hostility to going to war. Just from talking to people, I don't get any sense whatsoever that there was loyalty to empire. Some of them didn't even speak English, and they had no English ancestry whatsoever. The communities all around them were a mixture of Mi'kmaq and French, largely. So I don't get any sense of that. So that's a little different, and I do have some theories about why they did go to war in great numbers, but as to their wartime experience and resistance to it, it's early days yet. Thank you for such a good question.
Stephanie, I'm sure I speak for everybody here, intensely moved by your experience, and I think those of us here who've been at Beaumont Hamel, and many have, not everybody, it is an unforgettable experience. But I want to underline something. Beaumont Hamel is not simply a memorial to one of the regiment's engagements. Those plaques for you and your classmates, travel mates, whatever they were, laid wreaths, are the memorial, Newfoundland's memorial, today I suppose to be correct politically, Newfoundland and Labrador, but Newfoundland's memorial to the missing dead, to the Newfoundlanders who went overseas, died in the war, Newfoundland Mercantile Marine, the Royal Navy, and our regiment, and who have no known graves. And I think that's the true significance of Beaumont Hamel. It's the way, it's where we remember. I think Sean's point is unarguably correct, that Beaumont Hamel has been transformed into a symbol, rightly so, but let us not forget that there are 821 names on those plaques, and they're all men, who went overseas and not only did not come home, but we have no idea where their mortal remains lie.
Mm-hmm. When you're there, you can see they have a section, I think you referenced, where we did lay our wreaths, and that kind of mentions each of the areas, like the Mercantile Marine and the regiment itself, and it has the different names. So it does commemorate all of them, but I guess our primary focus being there was studying the Battle of Beaumont Hamel itself. And our professor, actually, Dr. Donald Nickel, had each of us kind of do a little research project beforehand on a soldier who'd been in that battle, so that was kind of our focus that day, to try to learn more about that part. But it's certainly worth mentioning, yes,
that
makes it's a... It has, yeah, certainly.
Yeah, and there's another symbol that gets lost in Beaumont Hamel. It's actually the original plaque, and we caught a glimpse of it right after the Parks Canada one in your very moving film. But it actually says, erected by the government and women of Newfoundland. And I think, and Sean and I actually had this debate at Robert's house the other day, that there's a missing voice in all of this. And that is a kind of gender analysis. And if we remember that the women's suffrage movement arose out of the experiences of World War I, and look at what the women were saying, it is neither Morris nor Coker's approach to the world. Now, it may seem very naive, but they were arguing that as homemakers, they were going to remake Newfoundland. And they stood above any party. And if you look at Sean's very interesting categorization, the difference between Morris and Coker, which I think is brilliant, they draw on both schools of thought. They want society to take responsibility for the multiple problems in Newfoundland, whether it's child welfare, lack of education, health, on and on we could go. They would prefer state intervention. They're saying that there is a collective responsibility, but they also recognize there's no money. And so this same generation of women who run the suffrage movement go out and found all sorts of voluntary organizations, not necessarily as their first choice, but because there was no other. But they are very much arguing that if our sons and brothers and husbands went away, and we're wounded or injured, at the end of the day, we want a better country. And I just hope that this kind of women's perspective somehow gets integrated into memories of the Great War. The other thing I would say is that one of their statements in their propaganda for their petition was, we see the women's movement as a peace movement. We want a say in public policy.
Thank you very much. Oh, I should tell, Moira started off telling the story about the white Indians. So we do, at the provincial archives, we have a number of references, including the player's card. But we recently had a journal that came in, it's 19 pages. So there's a fellow, Hibbs. And Hibbs, when he arrived in England, was greeted, and they said, we thought that you were all white Indians. Well, he was not amused with that, but then they thought they were Canadians, and then he was even more furious. And so he swore that it had nothing to do with the crowd in England, and so in his journal he continues, and when he gets back to Newfoundland, everyone is saying, what does Buckingham Palace look like? What was Trafalgar Square look like? All of these highlights of London. And he said, I never got to see any of them. So he was really embarrassed when he got home because he hadn't seen them. But he was so furious with the people that he initially met that rather than taking furlough in London, he would go on back to Scotland where he'd done some of his training. So when you next you're over to the rooms, I'll just show you those references.
Thank you.
Thank you, Orvin.
Great. I'm very proud of the fact that we've actually kept the overrun time to less than half an hour, and that's really good. But anyway, I think, you know, just to wrap up the proceedings, that I think, you know, what we've seen here in terms of the story, stories around Beaumont Hamel, complex, contradictory, fascinating, and it's still a living narrative, a living story. There's continually more and more to say about it, but also about the stories that get forgotten around the edges as well. And this is the end. Thanking my colleagues on the World War 100 Steering Committee, and particular thanks to Doug Ballam, who always works very, very hard to make sure that these events work. And to our partners, the Royal Newfoundland Regiment Advisory Council, who contributed lunch and the reception last night. Thanks very much. And to the Newfoundland Historical Society for the refreshment breaks, and also to the volunteers. Memorial University student ambassadors who helped us both last night and today. And to all of the presenters as well, who I think did an excellent job. I learned a hell of a lot myself. And finally, last but not least, to you, the audience. Thank you for coming out here and giving us your Saturday. Thanks very much.